My name's Paul Furlong. I'm a pastor and primarily an evangelist that travels the world conducting gospel healing, revival, crusades, and seeing great multitudes come unto repentance and into the kingdom of God through surrender and brokenness of heart unto the Lord Jesus Christ and the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm seeing blind eyes opened, lame walk, deaf, dumb, AIDS, cancer, every form of the powers of darkness and bondage and oppression delivered and healed and set free through the declaration and the bold preaching and the clear, simple gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to just share a few comments on homosexuality in the Bible, the Word of God. I also want to just bring up some points. I noticed Mark Connor from City Life here in Melbourne, Australia. I believe Melbourne's one of Melbourne's biggest churches has publicly made a statement, and I commend him on generally on his statement, but there are a few problems here that again I believe is facing the church in so many denominations, particularly through the Pentecostal movement, charismatic movement, that is watering down the gospel. Why can we not speak the gospel plain and clear as it is written, as it instructs us? Why must we always come from an angle that God loves and condones everything and everyone? Because this is a fake gospel. This is a false gospel. It is tickling the ears of those. It is a non-offensive gospel that seeks only to welcome everyone. Now, I believe everyone is welcomed into the kingdom of God, providing they come on the terms of God, providing that they come through belief and through repentance and through contriteness and to death in Jesus Christ, that we are born again unto a new nature, that is the seed of God. The old is passed away, all things become new. We are brought into the kingdom of God and called unto perfection, unto holiness, unto godliness, unto righteousness. Why is this gospel being eluded? Why is this gospel not being preached so clearly? Must we always try to tolerate every view and every belief so that we do not bring offense? We are told that the gospel is an offense. It is the rock that causes men to stumble. And we are told it is the word of God is a hammer that comes upon us. We are told that the word of God is a rock, and we must throw ourselves upon the rock and be broken, or the rock shall fall upon us and crush us into dust, into powder, and destroy us. The word of God is clear that we must come in repentance and in a change of mindset, a change of understanding, a change of heart unto obedience. You cannot have faith without obedience. The teaching on grace is become ridiculous in the sense that we use grace as an excuse to cover all our sins. That is not what grace is for. We are saved by grace, yes, through faith. If we have no faith, there is no grace. If we have not obedience, we have no faith. So let me just share the Bible. Now, first of all, let me say on the topic of homosexuality. Homosexuality clearly in the Bible is a sin along with every other sin. If we're going to point at homosexuality, we almost need to point at greed and murder, lies, and a numerous amounts of sins. So, look, I love every person that is a sinner. And Jesus had compassion on the multitudes, and his heart was moved, for God so loved the whole world, he gave his only son. Yet just because he opened, or he gave an invitation, I should say, to the whole world, because he loves them, does not mean that the whole world will be saved. It will only be those who respond and who receive according to his requirements that shall enter the kingdom of God. Secondly, if we tolerate, should we tolerate any sin? I believe not. We are told in the Word of God that number one, we as Christians, we are light in the darkness, and we are to put our light upon the hill and let it shine brightly. That now, what does light do? It exposes the darkness. It exposes that which is done in the darkness. The Bible says that they rejected Jesus, but they did not want to come into the light, as Jesus is the light of the world, because they were afraid that when the light is turned on, that which is done in darkness is exposed and revealed. The word comes to expose sin. This is a good thing. Yes, the word condemns sin. You say we're not condemned in Jesus. Exactly. When we are in Jesus, we are not condemned. If we are not in Jesus, i.e. if we're living in sin, we stand condemned. Jesus did not come to condemn the world, but to save the world. Why did he not come to condemn? Because the world stands condemned already. He came to save us from our condemnation, the condemnation and the penalty of our sin. If we're not condemned, what is there to save us from? Therefore, the world, and then it goes on, John 3:16 onwards, says, if we reject him, then he rejects us. If we accept him, then he accepts us. So let me say, first of all, we see very clearly in the Word of God, Leviticus 18 verse 22 says, you shall not lie with a male as one lies with a female. It is an abomination. Now, we could stop right there. The Word of God, that's clear enough. That it is abomination, it is a sin, it is unacceptable unto God to have a relationship, man on man, woman on woman, or with an animal or anything else for that matter. Leviticus 20 verse 13, if there be a man who lies with a male, as with those lie with a woman, both of them shall be committed a detestable act. They shall surely be both put together, their blood guiltiness is upon them. 1 Corinthians 6 verse 9 to 10, or do you not know that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. This is a warning, this is a clear teaching for us not to be deceived in any other mindset or put forth of instruction or understanding or whatever. Do not be deceived, neither fornicators nor adulterers nor idolaters nor effeminate nor homosexuals nor thieves nor covetous nor drunkards nor revilers nor swindlers shall inherit the kingdom of God. It's clear, these people shall not inherit the kingdom of God, that live lives as I've just read from the Word of God. Romans chapter 1 verse 26 to 28, for this reason God gave them over to degrading passions, for their women exchanged the natural function for that which is unnatural. And in the same way also the men abandoned the natural function of the woman and burned in their desire toward one another. Men with men committing indecent acts and receiving in their own persons the due penalty of their error. And just as they did not see fit to acknowledge God any longer, God gave them over to a depraved mind to do things which are not improper. We see here very clearly Sodom and Gomorrah was destroyed specifically because this ungodly, degrading, unnatural affection of sexual desire. And it was given to us as an example of destruction. Now, sin is sin. If we have committed one sin, we have committed them all. We won't get into this, but there certainly is different levels and grades of sin. However, the outcome of every single one of them, for there is no difference, Romans says. We have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There is no difference unto sin. If it is a simple lie or a homosexual act or murder or theft or whatever it may be, it is still sin and we stand condemned before God. Yes, I believe there'll be greater condemnation and greater punishment for different sins, yes. And so the Bible says very clearly here, and in fact the Bible pulls out the sin of homosexuality and lifts it up above most other sins, saying it is detestable, it is unnatural when you sin against your own body as God has created it to function, and so forth. One great ungodliness of this desire and sexual attraction is that they not only ignore the Word of God and continue to operate in a depraved mind and uncontrolled sensual sexual desire, but they condone it and declare it. It's in Romans 1 verse 32. And although they know the ordinance of God, that those who practice such things are worthy of death, they not only do the same, but also give hearty approval to those who practice them. And so we also see in part of this scripture that he who commits an indecent act of sexual immorality, and specifically of homosexuality, he who approves of these things really is sending a clear message and may be judged according to as he who does these things as well. So it is our job. Do you think it is? People say we should not condemn. Well, this is absolute rubbish. Brother, don't judge. Well, this is absolute rubbish. There is nowhere in the Word of God that says we are not to judge one another. Paul says, in fact, we are to judge those within the church, are to judge those within the church. Let God judge the world. But we have the Word of God that says very clearly and tells us to expose ungodliness. And judge it and declare it. If you're a lighthouse on a hill, you are shedding light all around, and therefore you're exposing through the Word of God, you're exposing ungodliness. We stand condemned. Sin condemns us. It is a good thing to be condemned. In fact, until you feel condemned, this is why the whole Old Testament and the law was given, to condemn us, to pierce us, to cause us clearly to be seen that we are helplessly lost and damned in our sin, if there is not a change of mindset, a change of heart, an action that follows it. John the Baptist says right now the axe is at the root, ready to cut down the tree that is not bringing forth fruit. He declares you must bring forth fruits of righteousness. And we are told, Jesus says, don't judge if you're a hypocrite. First get the log out of your own eye, then get the speck out of others. So we are told, first get your own life right, line it up according to the Word of God, and then go out and clean up other lives. And so forth. Praise the Lord. Now let me address Mark Connor's statement. First of all, he declares, or he just simplifies the stance that he believes are in three areas in churches in their action or belief or stance against homosexuality. One is that of change, that they believe that the homosexual must change according to the Word of God. The second is there is acceptance but not practice. Glad he made that clear. That we love as the phrase that we've come accustomed to, which I actually hate, is love the sinner, hate the sin, or hate the sin, love the sinner. And although it has a form of truth, there's no doubt about it, it's not sending a clear message. The third area is affirmation, and that is that you accept and you welcome the lifestyle, the desire, and the practice of the homosexual. Now, he declares that his church stands between change and acceptance, that they believe, yes, that it is a sin before God and you must change, but he also accepts those. And this is where I'm worried, that the public declaration he has made, that he does accept those who continue in desire. And that is a worry. That is a worry. Now let me just share a couple of statements that concern me that Mark Connor has publicly made. The first is that ultimately we are complete in Christ, not in marriage or sexual experience. What a lot of rubbish. What the heck is he trying to say here? We are complete in Christ besides our sexual experiences. I mean, man, come on. How foggy is that? How weak is that? You were saying that no matter what our sexual experiences, that we are saved in Jesus Christ? Did Jesus come and die and shed his blood and pay such a great sacrifice that we may continue in sin guiltlessly? No. He died to pardon and forgive our sin, but far more than that, and that is to destroy the hold and the captivity and the dominion and the power of sin in our lives, that we are free. Whom the Son sets free is free indeed. It is finished, it is done, it is completed. Jesus came to pardon and to deliver us from the curse of sin, the bondage and the hold of sin. And we are now called out holiness unto holiness. What does holiness mean? mean? It means separated unto. What are we separated from? Sin. Who are we separated unto? Jesus Christ. If we read the word of God right through the epistles and the teaching of Jesus, is that we are called unto perfection. You say, oh, come on, we can't be perfect. Well, hang on a second. We are called unto perfection. That's the word of God. You either believe what you read, or you just, some people just read what they believe. But we need to take the whole word of God, and we are born of a new seed of God himself, the Father, and we are separated, sanctified, made holy, called unto holiness and unto perfection and unto godliness. We are told to take control of our bodies. We are told to take control of our minds, get them washed by the word of God. And so that statement, ultimately we are complete in Christ, not in marriage or sexual experience, is I condemn that statement as a weak, heartless, ungodly statement that opens the door for people to continue in whatever sexual experiences they want to or desire, yet it remains that they are complete in Christ. That is a total contradiction to the Word of God and the Gospel of God. The second statement he makes is Jesus doesn't shame or reject you. He loves you. Well, again, what a half-truth and half-lie in this statement. Jesus doesn't shame or reject you. Well, first of all, Jesus does condemn us in our sin. And we stand condemned in our sin. And if we continue in our sin, the Word of God says that we will be damned. We will enter, be separated from God. He will send us to hell. And there is no hope for us. And he that continues in such a lifestyle of sin, the Word of God says very clearly, there remains no hope, but rather the wrath and the judgment of Almighty God. Now, does God reject you? Yes, he does reject you. Hell is full of men and women today that God loved, yet he rejected them. Many are called, but few are chosen. Broad and wide is the road that leads unto destruction, and most walk in it. Straight and narrow is the road that leads unto eternal life, and sadly few find it. God's word and the gospel clearly declares if you continue in your sin, do not deceive yourselves. In Ephesians, in Galatians, and in Corinthians, it said in three separate books very clearly, do not deceive yourselves. He who continues in sin, and it lists those amongst homosexuality and murder and greed. I'm not just, the topic today is homosexuality, but in reality, it doesn't matter what sin it is. If you continue in sin, do not be deceived. You will not have a part in the kingdom of God. You will not enter the kingdom of God. We are told this very clearly in the Word of God. So, Mark Connor, when you stand there and declare publicly, and leaders and those of us that are preachers of the gospel, we judge more severely. And many people write on your words. They shouldn't. They should write on the Word of God. But of a church of some 10,000 people, to stand up and declare that Jesus does not shame you, Jesus does not reject you, he loves you, is a false, dangerous, ungodly statement. The Bible says, consider both the kindness and the severity of God, and to daily work at our salvation with fear and trembling, for our God is a consuming fire. It declares that the bodies of the Israelites who were set free, mighty signs and wonders and deliverance given, out of bondage, he led them out of Egypt into the promised land. Yet that whole generation, it says their bodies were laid decaying and destroyed in the wilderness as an example unto us to not forsake the faith. They were left there because they did not mix faith, which is action, unto the word of God. Jesus tells us a parable. He who built a house upon the sand is he who heard the word and believed the word, but did not obey it. And the house fell when the storm came, and how great and complete was its destruction. But he that heard, he that believed, and he that obeyed, the key factor here, I believe, in salvation is yes, faith, believing and faith, but obedience. You see, the devil believes and the demons believe, and they tremble and they shudder at the very thought. And this is like the man who built his house upon the rock. And when the storm came and the time of testing, he stood firm. Praise God. So Jesus does reject you. It says very clearly in the Word of God, if you reject him, he rejects you. We must die with him if we wish to be resurrected unto newness of life. Hallelujah. On the topic of same-sex marriage, he quoted, quote, Mark Connor, I encourage you to form your own opinion. Now, okay, maybe this is a little bit misunderstood, but again, this is not very clear. We are not to form our own opinion. We take on the opinion of the Word of God. Let's not become humanistic. Let's not become proud and arrogant and make up our own mind. I'm not condemning this statement completely, but it's not fully complete. We must encourage us to form our own opinion according and based on the Word of God. You say, but some people misread the Word of God. You cannot misread the Word of God according to the scriptures I've just quoted to you. It is clear. If you misread it, then you are a fool. Okay. Another quote that Mark Connor made here was right doctrine, wrong attitude. He declares if we have the right doctrine and the wrong attitude, then we are completely wrong. Now, I struggle with that statement. In fact, our attitude should be based upon our doctrine. Well, not our doctrine, the Word of God. You know what I'm saying. The Word of God, doctrine of the Word of God, should the outcome of that should be our attitude. And our attitude should be based on the doctrine of the Lord Jesus Christ. What is the problem these days with so much watered down, weak gospel? That we are afraid to offend anyone. That we are afraid. Jesus got mad. He got angry, righteously angry. He went in with a whip, turned over the tables, whipped people, and man, and the way he attacked the hypocrites, and those, the disciples at one stage had to drag him away, saying, "Jesus, come on, what are you doing? You realize you're offending, grossly offending these people. Come on." Jesus said, "They're blind guides leading the blind. They're a bunch of dead, whitewashed tombs, just painting themselves white on the outside, but filthy and putrid on the inside." He declared, "Unless your righteousness becomes more than the Pharisees, you will not even enter the kingdom of God." And I could go on and on here. One more quote, Mark Connor. He declares that the church should be the safest place to pull down your mask and be real. Well, I don't quite understand exactly what the point he's trying to make here and the message he's trying to give in here. What was he saying, that everyone can just come and live as they want to without trying to hide who they are? Now, I believe absolutely no person should be hiding who they are in the Word of, in the church, that they should be openly declaring their lives. And if their lives are found, Paul says, daily work out your salvation. Paul says, test yourself to see if you are in the faith. Paul says, check yourself to see if you are worthy of the gospel. See if you're worthy of the calling of God. So to make a statement, the church should be the safest place to pull down your mask and be real. What are you saying, that everyone can just live as they want to be because they won't be judged? They won't be condemned? They won't be had a finger pointed at them? They won't be corrected? They won't be rebuked? I mean, come on. Come on. Let's get the Word of God clear. Let's get it right. And let our attitude be, absolutely, Jesus had compassion on the sinners. When the woman was caught in adultery and thrown before Jesus, he had compassion on her, and he forgave her her sin. And then what did he say? "Now go and sin no more." Let me make a statement. I have no problems with homosexualities or murderers or thieves or liars or anyone, for we were all that once. I have no problem with any of these people entering church and coming to hear the Word of God. But the moment they decide to surrender their lives to God and declare themselves to be Christians, they can no longer remain in sin. And Paul dealt with this very, very clearly. In fact, the other area I like to say in as Mark opened up was 1 Corinthians chapter 13, saying that the description of love. And he was saying how it declares that we don't see things clearly now. And we don't see things completely. But what are you trying to say here? We do see it clearly as far as sin and as far as homosexuality. It is sin, full stop, no matter what it is condemned. And the wages and the penalty of sin is death and hell. And for us to not condemn sin is, in fact, not love. For love, the wounds of a friend, iron sharpens iron. In fact, to declare the word of God, first we must be condemned. We must clearly understand that we are condemned, that we are damned, that we have no hope if we continue in our sin, and that must lead us. People say, oh, but God just loves you. Hang on a second. The kindness of God and the love of God, we know the scripture, his kindness leads us unto repentance. So people say, oh, it's the love, it's the kind, it's the loving kindness of God that leads us. Well, yes, it is the love of God that convicts us and shows us clearly that unless we repent, unless we change, unless we hear the word of God and respond accordingly in contriteness. What does contriteness mean? It means a sense of brokenheartedness over our sin and offense unto God. Unless we truly repent. Repentance means, again, a change of heart, a change of mindset and understanding followed through with action. Someone said to me, repentance simply means a change of mindset. It doesn't mean to turn from your sin. Well, a lot of garbage. Look it up. Every time repentance is talked about in the scripture, it is accompanied by brokenheartedness and forsaking of sin. Jesus called the man down who was lowered down, remember, through the roof, and who was paralyzed. He said, rise, your sins are forgiven. And he said, rise, go and sin no more. And so we are called, once we are repentant and turn to God, we are called to live a life of sinlessness. You say, but we are just saved sinners. Oh, rubbish. You cannot be both. You cannot be a sinner and be saved. You are either a sinner or you are saved. Once you are saved, you are called to cease from your sin, to depart from your sin, and to live a sinless life. But sure, we all stumble, we all fall. And if we sin, thank God, he said, if you sin and if you confess your sin, he is faithful and just to forgive you of your sin and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Now let me say, does it say when we sin or if we sin? It says if we sin. That means that we are not expected to sin. And the odd occasion as we are maturing and as we're growing, if we do stumble and fall, the steps of a righteous man are ordered by the Lord. Though he fall, he shall not be cast down. The Lord lifts him up with his strong and mighty right hand. Praise God. If you sin, and if you confess your sin in brokenness and change of heart, he will wash, pardon, cleanse, and forgive you. If we repent, it means we do not do it again. We do not continually are stuck in this habit or lifestyle of sin. For if we continue in habitual sin and lifestyle of sin, Paul says we trample the blood of Jesus under our feet, and his sacrifice shall no longer redeem us, or cleanse us, or pardon us from our sin. What shall we say? Shall we sin more because grace abounds more? God forbid. We are not given grace, and we ought not to receive grace as a license unto sin. Paul says we ought not to receive. Be careful. Be careful you do not receive grace in vain. That is for no purpose. For no purpose whatsoever. Grace is given to empower us to live a godly, righteous, holy life. Jesus says, be holy as I am holy. And he calls us unto holiness. So let me clarify, does Jesus love the sinner? Yes, in the sense that he loves the whole world and desires that they may be saved, that we may be saved. So God loves the homosexual, God loves a murderer in the sense that he is offering them an opportunity to turn from their sin, to forsake their sin, and receive the good news, the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. For the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, Jesus declared, to bring the good news, but also to declare the vengeance and the wrath of our God Almighty. And so we are called to forsake and to repent and to cry out, to call upon the name of the Lord. On the day of Pentecost, Peter preached that great sermon, and he pointed the finger directly at those who crucified Jesus. You crucified Jesus. And he condemned them in their sin. And so much that the word of God, they were pierced to the heart and they cried out, what must we do to be saved? What must we do to put this right and not face the consequences? For we have made a grave mistake in our sin. And Peter said, weep cry out, fall to your knees, wail and repent and call upon the name of the Lord until he hears from heaven and comes and showers his righteousness upon you. Amen. Praise God. May God bless you. I hope I've clarified a godly response to Pastor Mark Connor of City Life Church in Melbourne. And I pray that God will enable him to take a clear stand. He's halfway there, I believe, and so I do not condemn everything he says, but I just wish he'd be more clearer. Now, let me make a comment also. If we condone sin, then we are as guilty as the sinner. And to allow sin to remain within the church is a clear statement that you are allowing it, therefore you are condoning it, and it makes us guilty as the sinner. Mark declared in 1 Corinthians 13, he talks about love, and we're not seeing things clearly, but he's talking about love of God. Yes, I totally agree with that love of God, but let's also read how Paul treated that church and treated the sin, and the sexual sin, in fact. He treated them, and he declared very clearly that you kick that brother out of the church. You expose sin publicly. Listen, it is sin. Jesus said sin is like a bit of leaven mixed through the loaf. It spreads through the whole loaf. If you want to talk about sin and talk about hell, then just read every single one of the parables of the Lord Jesus Christ. For just about every one declares the wages of sin is death and hell. Jesus preached on hell more than heaven because he knows how real it is and desires us to run from it, flee from it, and run into the arms of God. God loves you. God is compassionate. He is a God of kindness, but he is a God of severity. He is a God of love and grace and mercy and kindness and patience, but he is a God of vengeance and a God of wrath, and he will not tolerate sin. And it's his love that should drive us and open our eyes. Paul says it's his kindness, loving kindness, that leads us to repentance. So therefore, don't take for granted this loving kindness. You say, but you are okay. Where's the judgment of God? Yet at any moment, the ground beneath us may give way, and we may plummet and fall into the fires of hell. And Paul talks about rescuing those from sin and from the very flames of the fire of hell, hating the smell of the flames in their clothing, but reaching out and pulling them out unto salvation. Praise the Lord. The power of God is mighty to deliver and to save. He comes to set you free. He comes to heal the broken hearts. He comes to deliver you. He comes to those that are bound by demon powers and by darkness to release you, to break the chains that bind, to open the prison doors and to set you free. There is healing, body, soul, and mind in the gospel, and it's a power of God that leads unto salvation and the love of God. Run into the arms of God. But in obedience and in brokenness and in contriteness and in repentance, and ye shall be saved. Let us make a stand against sin very clearly. Let's not make it so foggy that no one even understands what you're saying. Let's not compromise the word of God. Let's preach it clearly in the name of Jesus. God bless you.
To be with you, to live with you, to laugh with you every day, each and every day of my life. All I want is to be with you, to live with you, to laugh with you every day, each and every day of my life. I could climb every mountain and tread through every valley, face the fire and the darkness, if only your presence stand by me. I could climb every mountain, tread through every valley, face the fire and the darkness, if only your presence stand by me. 'Cause all I want is to be with you, to live with you, to laugh with you every day, each and every day of my life. 'Cause all I want is to be with you, to live with you, to laugh with you every day, each and every day of my life. I can live through the pain and the sorrow, with you I can face tomorrow. Every day I will love you more, if only your presence stand by me. I can live through the pain and the sorrow, with you I can face tomorrow. Every day I will love you more, if only your presence stand by me. 'Cause all I want is to be with you, to live with you, to laugh with you every day, each and every day of my life. 'Cause all I want is to be with you, to live with you, to laugh with you every day, each and every day of my life. 'Cause all I want is to be with you, to live with you, to laugh with you every day, each and every day of my life.